Here at Atlanta Live. I'm Rebecca Keener. I'll be your host tonight, and thank you for joining us. It's going to be a wonderful time together, and we've got some wonderful worship in the house with the Pylant family. I've been enjoying talking to them and hearing their testimony. It's just extraordinary what God has done in their life and in their family, and you're going to enjoy hearing from them and worshiping with them all night long. And then we have a very special guest tonight who was a special request just for you and for all of us to hear from, our president and manager here at WATC, Greg West. And everybody likes to hear from Greg West. He's a behind the scenes guy, and every now and then he'll agree to come out here and just give you an update on what's going on here at Atlanta Live and at the station. And we just love to hear from Greg. So you're going to enjoy that tonight, and I pray all is well with you and that the Lord is just blessing you at this time. And I was thinking about this program and how it's just kind of 1 hour. It's a power hour, and you may want to get on the phone and call some friends and tell them to join in the power hour. There's enough of the bad news, and you can just turn that off and turn on Atlanta Live every single night right here at 7 o'clock. And just get great worship, great praise, great prayer. And we also have a prayer line as well here at Atlanta Live that's been going for many years. There's staff here who pray over your needs. And we want to hear from you. We need to hear from you. And this station has been here 25 plus years. And so God has used it in a powerful way. And Atlanta needs this station. Amen. I'm just going to say that. And just spreading the gospel, the good news. We've got enough of the bad news. We need some good news, the good news of Jesus Christ beaming out of this station every single night. So we pray that you're blessed tonight, and we want to hear from you. If you have any needs or you need somebody to pray with you, we want to do that and be praying over your prayer needs. So you can be in touch with us at the phone number on your screen, or either you can email us here and someone will be praying for you. And I just pray that while you're listening in tonight, that it's just like an altar in your home, and you can just bring all of your challenges and your concerns and your needs and any fear that you have and just lay it on the altar and just allow the Holy Spirit just to minister to you and to bring comfort and bring peace and joy into your home, and just to let you know that He's with you no matter what we're facing as a nation, as a church, as families, that God is with us and His Holy Spirit is leading us. And we just pray for this 1 hour that God will just touch you and your family in a very special way. We're going to go to the music set now, and the Pylant family is going to be singing two songs for us, The Ground is Level and Sinner Saved by Grace. Enjoy.
With money to burn, baby, survival is your main concern. You may be world famous, but what good might it be? For the ground is level at Calvary.
Oh, the ground is level at Calvary.
Or a lawyer, a beggar, or a child. it makes God no difference who walks down the aisle. He said, whosoever will, let him come unto me, for the ground is level at Calvary.
Oh, the ground is level at Calvary.
It's wholly accessible for you and for me, no matter who or what or when or where you may be. The ground is level at Calvary.
Yeah.
Oh, the ground is level at Calvary. It's wholly accessible for you and for me, no matter who or what or when or where you may be. The ground is level at Calvary.
That was the Pylant family, and you guys sound awesome. So we're looking forward to hearing more from you tonight, and a great interview from them. They're going to be just sharing and just encouraging you in the Word. and it's going to be a great time, so stay right there. But right now, we have somebody on the set with us tonight who has a great I told him he has a fan club out there, and he's so humble. He's just a humble soul, a humble leader, and he is the president of WATC and Community Television. And I want you to welcome tonight Greg West. Thank you for being here.
Good to be here.
I can't believe we got you out here.
If people, anyone who knows me knows I like being behind the scenes, behind the wall.
Yeah, well, thank you for coming. You work so hard, and you are a humble leader and a humble soul. And really, there's a reflection of that in the staff here, just across the board. Everyone here just carries that spirit of Christ and so humble. And I think that comes from the top down.
Well, I don't know if I can take credit for it, but we have a wonderful crew and staff, and just, you know, we have some new people that just have joined us. We have some people who've been here for 20 plus years.
So amazing.
We have a nice mix of people.
Yeah, and you've been with WATC for how long?
1862, I believe.
Ah!
It seems like a long time. No, I was at the Greenville station, which is founded by Jimmy and Joanne Thompson.
Yes.
Many years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I worked there for a number of years and then moved down here in 95, and we signed on the air in 96.
Wow.
In April of 96.
That's amazing. And this is such a beautiful studio for people who've never been down here.
This was a manufacturing warehouse when we first moved in.
I didn't know that.
And it was in shambles, basically.
Wow.
So there was a lot going on to get everything renovated. Some of the offices were built, but most of them weren't. And it was a lot of construction and sheetrock and planning it went on and moving equipment and then moving equipment again because we had to work on that area. So it was.
So you saw it before it ever was a studio.
Oh yes. Oh yes. Yes.
Well, I have been to the studio in Greenville as well, uh-huh. And it was the first one.
Right.
And you said they're coming up on 50 years?
In October, they'll be 50 years old.
Wow, mm-hmm. That is amazing.
As best as we can figure, they are the longest running Christian television station that still serves the local market.
That is amazing.
Like Pat Robertson started the station many years ago, but it became CBN.
Yeah.
But as far as a station serving the community, Greenville is, best we can tell, is the oldest.
Wow.
That's continually running.
And then this station celebrated last year our 25th.
Right. So we're rolling. I've already even passed our 26th now. So,
wow. Right here off of I-85.
That's right. And you know, I think back to maybe it's an age thing or something, but it doesn't seem like it's been 26 years.
Yeah.
You know, I remember when this was a warehouse that was empty and
in
shambles and the work it went on to get it ready. And Betty Cornett, who you know so well and our viewers know so well, mm-hmm. She brought a team of prayer partners and they marched around the studio, what was to be our studio, and just circled it in prayer.
Wow.
And then it became our studio. You know, we kept working on it. And it's, you know, equipment, we had equipment that would barely work, but did work enough to get us on the air and all. But the Lord's provided, and we've added new equipment and expanded, and we're just blessed. That's all I can say is we're just really blessed.
It is. And when I say I feel deep in my soul that Atlanta needs this station.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, of course, it now goes out all over the world.
Right.
But our heart
is still, you know, first and foremost, Atlanta.
Yes.
And so we want to be here for the city and offer programming that blesses and encourages. And we're working on some new ideas for the fall that we're working on now.
Right.
And, you know, COVID really set us back a little bit as far as our plans and all, but this fall you should see some new shows and we have some new productions coming in, and it's going to be busy this summer.
That's exciting.
Yeah.
Well, you know, you think about this particular program airing 5 nights a week live.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know any other station in Atlanta other than news stations mm-hmm. that are airing a program live like this. How do you do it 5 nights a week?
Well, there's wonderful producers and directors and camera people and everybody involved. It makes it happen. It was always, I'll go back to the Thompsons. It was the heart of the Thompsons to serve the local community and have a platform for pastors in the area to come and share and minister. And when they founded the Atlanta station, they wanted the same thing for here. And that's when Atlanta Live started. And we started up at a dear friend of ours' studio up in Woodstock, Georgia. And it was a small studio. And so a good rainstorm could take us off the air. I mean, that's how fragile the station was at the time. But we started in a studio up there, and it was just a very simple setup. But it really was, you could just feel the presence of the Lord. It was like this was the start of something big.
Wow.
You know, and so then we were able to come to the Norcross studio, and it's just been a blessing. You know, there's so much that goes on during the day in here, and then, of course, the live program at night. It's so many ministries are a part of us, and we appreciate each and every one of them.
Yeah. And, you know, you do feel the presence of the Lord when you come in here. You know, I can be tired and think, oh, I don't know if I'm going to do a good job on Atlanta Live or whatever, but you hit the property and you feel something special here. Have you always felt that way?
I'll go back to a Jimmy and Joanne story. Joanne saw this building and she said, this is it. She said, this is where we're supposed to be.
Wow.
Now, mind you, that was before any engineering studies or anything were done. She was signing the lease, basically. And so we were concerned because we found out that the equipment might not reach our transmitter site from here.
Wow.
So the microwave tower is right on the very corner of our building here because that was the only way we could get by the billboards on 85.
Wow.
But this was the building it was supposed to be.
Amazing. Mm-hmm. And you had to learn all of this technical behind the scenes.
Oh, I can assure you, I surround myself with people who are much more technical than I am. I know in generalities, but I definitely defer to people who know a lot more than I do with technical, because I feel like back in the day, you know, I remember when my parents got VCR for the first time. And, you know, they never would reset the 12 o'clock blinky light on it.
Yeah,
you know,
and that was me.
You know, it was so simple.
Yeah.
Let me do it. You know, now I'm the parent. Like I don't understand how a lot of this works, but it does.
It's changing like that, isn't it?
It is changing.
Yeah.
And television is changing a lot.
It is. You know, I was able to see you and Michael and some of the team at NRB, mm-hmm. and that was kind of an overall theme of how quickly things are changing in Christian media.
Right, and the way you refer to it is exactly it. It's Christian media. Mm-hmm. We don't produce TV programs anymore. We produce content.
Mm.
And so content can be online or it can be available on different platforms.
Yeah.
It's not just over the air now. So it's definitely, we're expanding into that space. We've been in it for a while, but we're continuing to expand in it. We have a second channel here we call WATC2, which airs on our .2. We're going to do a revamp of that channel and refresh it a little bit for fall. So we have some big plans.
That's exciting. There's always something going on here.
Well, you know, the to-do list is quite long.
I can't even imagine.
But you know, it you just work as you can, it's fun to see how it can continue to grow. And you know, the best thing for me is, you know, I got thinking about when I said I'd be on the program. I got counting it up. In 2 months, I will have been in Christian TV for 38 years.
My goodness.
Don't
even look 38.
I'd like to say I started at 10, but that isn't. I can't do it. I can't
do
it. No one would believe me. But 38 years, and
congratulations.
I've seen so much change through those years. But the best thing is, retirement will be at some point. The best thing is to lay the foundation for the next generation.
That's right.
To keep going and even go further.
Yes.
And so that's kind of in the season I feel like I'm in right now is laying some groundwork for the next generation, the next season.
That's awesome. Mm-hmm. And you've got some great young men and women behind the scenes.
Yes.
And men and women behind the scenes.
Oh,
here.
Yes.
And they're just so impressive. Many of them come from SCAD and other places mm-hmm. that come and work here. And then you've got some like Paul and Charlotte and John and that have been here for years and years.
They've built it. Yes, and they have this, as many stories as I do. You know,
I love
and,
it.
And it, you know, we really have a heart for Christian media, and the, you know, because it goes into homes mm. when maybe a church person doesn't know to go there to witness to somebody.
Yeah.
You know, maybe someone's having a bad day or they just need a word of encouragement.
Mm-hmm.
We're on. And they can flip by and check prayer line and everything.
Yeah, you won't even know all the stories probably till you get to heaven. And then
you'll know all the
people that were touched. You know, I was reading your biography and or your bio that mm-hmm. Charlotte gave me. And one thing I didn't know about you was that you picked up a book at a drugstore at age 10 on the history of TV.
I did. That's really what's kind of sparked my interest in television. It was just this paperback book, and I just read it cover to cover. I just found it fascinating.
At 10.
Uh-huh. And so I'll tell the story quickly. When I was deciding what my major would be in college, I decided I'd go into radio TV.
Okay.
So, and I did, and so I graduated, and here I am, world, and, you know, the phone wasn't ringing. You know, it was a hard field to get into at the time back in the 80s.
Yes.
And I heard of a new station going on the air in Burlington, North Carolina. So I kind of kept sending resumes to get a foot in the door, and it happened to be a Christian TV station launching.
Wow.
And so, but I went back to my home church a little bit, you know, after I was working in Christian TV then. I was back in my home church. And I remember at 10 years old or 11 years old, actually producing the church service in my mind as a TV program.
My goodness.
And it really, like, it was like a confirmation that, you know, like I was where I was supposed to be.
Oh, yeah.
And it hit me so real. And I hadn't ever put it all together till.
And then it just fits like a glove, doesn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, and it, then you see it. So many times, you know, you don't know why you're going through something or why you do something. But then when you're on the other side of it, you can see exactly what God wanted you to learn from it and how you grew from it and how it connected.
Amazing.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a tapestry.
It just
weaves together the pieces of our life and brings the right people here to get the job done.
That's right.
It's just amazing. Did you ever, as a child, did you play television like you were doing a television show?
No, because I was always behind the scenes. I was never. But I can remember, like, school projects.
Yeah.
Usually had a TV theme to it of some sort.
Wow.
And I mean, I really did. I just really gravitated to this industry. Mm. And I didn't know, you know, at the time, you know, I'm back from the day before cable television was really exploding. And so CBS, NBC, and ABC was all there was out there. And the doors weren't as wide to go into this industry as it is now.
Mm-hmm.
And so all my friends in college, when they were graduating, they were all getting offers for their entry-level jobs. And, you know, I'm like, hello. But it about a year after I graduated was when the door opened for me. And it's been quite an experience from North Carolina to South Carolina to now Georgia.
Is there maybe somebody that has been through the studio that sticks out in your mind that had a big impact on your work through the year? I'm putting you on the spot.
I'll give you a story that comes to mind when you say that. Really is not for here in Atlanta, but it's for me as a whole.
Yeah.
There was a pastor who was one of the hosts up in Burlington, North Carolina, when I was first starting. And his name was H.O. Jenkins, and he was a Pentecostal holiness pastor, as country as the day is long. And he'd play fiddle in church, you know, like, I mean, but viewers loved him, and he was just who he was. When you saw him on TV, it was who he was, and when you saw him in public, it was who he was.
Wow.
And he laid such a foundation for me of showing the heart of a pastor in the experience of television.
It's good.
Like, viewers would call and he would go and see them in hospitals and things like that.
Wow.
You just had a really pastor's heart. And I know you can't always do that. I understand. But I hold on to that because it's like whenever you get discouraged, it's like there's a realness to it.
Yeah.
And that is he was somebody who really impacted me
through
the years. And I wanted to, once I got here in Atlanta and into the position here, mm-hmm. I really wanted to try to find him, to just let him know. It was really heavy on me to let him know what he did for me, because you know, you need people like that in your life help lay foundation.
Sure.
And I wanted to tell him, but unfortunately he was older and I finally learned that he had passed.
Wow.
So I didn't never get to tell him that.
Wow.
But he, you know, you never know what impact you're making on the next generation.
That's the truth. And you know, he's looking over the balconies of heaven and he's cheering you on.
Well, I'm thankful for having him in my life. He really,
that's awesome.
Yeah, he really did play a part.
You know, last question I wanted to ask you is, I know there's times of intense pressure in this arena. I can't even imagine the warfare. You feel that responsibility here and for you, and we pray for you. But what is your why? Why do you just, year after year, why do you keep doing it and leading and serving and doing what you're doing?
It's my heart and it's my world. I love the opportunity. You know, I'm every day I'm thankful for getting to do what I get to do.
Wow.
Now, there are days that I don't want to have to do what I have to do that day.
Yeah.
But because it might be something stressful.
Yeah.
But all in all, I'm so thankful because I always wanted to work in a creative environment.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm a little unusual because I do come from a creative background, more so in a production background than I do a ministry background. You know, I didn't go to a Bible college or anything. Mm-hmm. So I come at this a little differently than some of the TV station people through the country, but I think we complement each other because, you know, like I work with them on a lot of projects and they work with us, and you know, I think it works well.
That's awesome. And you still produce Babby's House.
I still am involved with Babby's House and Friends and Neighbors and a couple of these new things that are coming up for the fall.
Exciting.
So yeah, you know.
That's great.
I like wearing a few hats.
Well, that's awesome. And you do it well, and you have been such a blessing to me over the years. The first time I walked in the door, I think it was 2010, and I just felt like I was at home.
Well,
I don't
good.
Know what it was.
You want everybody to feel that.
Everybody says that about coming to WATC.
And if anyone has ever thought about having a television program, it's more doable than you may think. Call us and find out.
That's awesome.
Yes.
That's
I didn't mean to do a sales pitch.
No, I think people need to know that because there may be some people out there tonight who maybe have that in their spirit like I did and thought, well, that's not ever possible.
Right.
But then, you know, I sat down with you and Michael and you made what was impossible to me possible.
Right.
We
have a lot of options now. So
it's awesome.
Yes.
Well, it's a great place to be, and thank you for your leadership. Thanks for coming and being with us.
Well, thank you for inviting me.
Come back again.
I will.
Okay. God bless you, Greg. Okay. We're going to go back to the music set with the Pylant family, and they're singing two songs, Sinners Saved by Grace and When They Ring the Bells of Heaven.
What I once was, if you can go with me back to where I started from, then I know you would see the miracle of love that took me in its sweet embrace and make me what I am today, a sinner saved by grace. I'm just a sinner saved by grace.
Morning.
having camp meeting around here tonight. Thank you so much. That's the Pylant family. And just stay right there because we're going to hear their miracle story behind this family traveling and singing, and the Lord is using them in a very mighty way. And that was Aaron Pylant singing the solo. You're going to hear his story as well. That was powerful. I pray it blessed you as it did us. We were dancing and shouting and raising our hands. That's what it's all about, is just lifting our hands together. We're just like one big church gathered together and worshiping the Lord tonight. And I pray it lifts your spirit and that you just feel the presence of the Holy Spirit as they're singing. It has been a wonderful time together. And we do have a prayer line here as well. If you want to call or email us here any prayer requests, we want to encourage you to do that. That's why WATC exists. And wasn't it great to hear from our president, Greg West, who just encouraged us and just kind of gave you a little update behind the scenes of what takes place in this wonderful studio. Night after night, you can tune in and just be encouraged and blessed. Turn off all the bad news and turn on the good news. Amen. But we love you, and we pray that you feel the love of Jesus Christ coming through that camera tonight. And if you don't know Him as Lord and Savior, that's the greatest decision that you can ever make in your life, is to give your life to Jesus Christ. Get in His Word. Get in a good church. There's so many you can get in and just be blessed. Amen. We're going to go to a short devotion, roll in, and transition over to the music set while we're doing it. So stay with us. We'll be right back.
Genesis chapter 35, there is an amazing story of how Rachel gave birth to a young son. In her dying breath, she was given the opportunity to name that baby, and she named that baby Benoni. That name means son of my sorrow. And it was her way of saying that bringing him in took me out, because she would die giving birth to that baby. But when Jacob walked in and inquired of the name, the Bible said that he changed that baby's name to Benjamin. The name Benjamin means son of power, son of my right hand. And I draw inspiration from that because the father changed the name on that baby. Jacob called him Benjamin. I don't know what mother circumstance has named you. I don't know what your trials or your problems have called you, but the Father says you're blessed and you're highly favored. I love you. I'll see you next time on Just a Minute.
Welcome back, everybody. I'm Rebecca Keener. We're on the music set here at Atlanta Live, and I told you it was going to be a power hour tonight, and it really has been. Thank you, Pylant family, for being with us tonight.
Thank you for
having God bless
us.
You.
Bless
Thank you,
you
so much.
You.
Y'all are great singers.
Oh.
Amazing. I just felt the presence of the Lord in this place in a great way, and thank you so much for being here. You are Brandon and Melina, mm-hmm. and your kids, Aaron and Bethany,
yes.
sister-in-law, Alicia Terry.
Yeah.
Very good. Thank y'all for coming all the way from Alabama.
Yeah. Yeah.
This little town called Eva, Alabama.
Okay.
And a little south of Huntsville. Usually when we tell someone where we're from, we say Huntsville.
Yeah.
Most people know because NASA and all that's up there. We're just
yeah.
a little south of Huntsville.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
And how long have y'all been singing? And just kind of give us a little background
sure.
on your group.
2008 is when we really just started stepping on stages and singing. In 2003, Alicia down there came to our little house and even knocked on the door, crying. She was upset. And, well, not upset, but just you could tell she was wearisome. And she said, I've got this burden.
Yeah, she had a burden.
She had a burden. And she said, somehow, some way, we're supposed to sing one day as a family together.
Wow.
We had been singing with other quartets and such. And 2005 years later, 2008 come around, and we've been singing as a family ever since.
Wow, that's amazing. Night. Did you ever see this night? You'd be on live TV, Alicia?
I did not.
Well, y'all handled it like you do it all the time.
It's a blessing just to be able to stand up and, you know, tell what God has done for our family.
Wow.
So.
That's powerful. What part do you sing?
I sing alto, low alto,
okay.
And stack with Bethany.
Okay, awesome. Mm-hmm. And Bethany, you just graduated from high school.
Yes, ma'am.
And you just have such a beautiful spirit about you.
Thank you.
And just beautiful voice as well.
Thank you very much.
And what's in the future for you? You're just going to keep singing for the Lord? And
And I'm going to go into college. I'm wanting to go into graphic designing is what I'm going into college for.
Awesome.
She's actually already registered for her fall semester.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And she got an academic scholarship, too.
Wow. So, yeah. That's amazing. And Aaron, I can tell, are you the star of the family?
Yes, ma'am.
He is, yes.
And you have such a powerful, powerful testimony, don't you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Was it at age 6 or when you you actually spoke for the first time?
Very first words around the age of 6, Dad can tell it just maybe a little clearer than he could.
It's an amazing story. And when he started singing just a few minutes ago, and we've sang hundreds and hundreds and thousands of times, but every time he sings that song, I have to just take a breath because what you see is a miracle.
Yeah.
Did not speak 1 year old, 2 years old, 3 years old.
Yeah.
He was in his own world. I'm reminded of Psalm 139 says that we're fearfully and wonderfully made.
Yes.
And there's no mistake that God makes. And so it just, Aaron developed later, but he wasn't like all the other kids. And so there were hard moments and times when we'd be out and kids will be kids, making fun of, but then we run into where adults were the same. And it made life hard. We didn't know how to really go out in society and function. We went to church all the time, and they were very acceptive. But society in the whole, back 16, 17, 18 years ago, still figuring out all the diagnosis of everything.
Yeah.
And he was sort of alienated from things. And if you fast forward, and I'd never heard him say, Dad. And I'd been a dad for 6 years, but never heard those words until that one faithful day. And the doctors, and I love doctors, and I appreciate what they do.
Sure.
But they don't know everything.
Yeah. Amen.
In 2006, we were told that he would never speak a true word.
Mm.
They said after all the battery of tests that they've done that day at UAB, and great people, but for this scenario, they got it wrong because they said, Mom, tell them what the diagnosis was.
Yes, they ran him through all these tests it was an all-day thing. And they came to us with this big, thick folder, and he kind of put it aside and said, Mr. and Ms. Pylant, I'm just going to tell you. He is 6 years old, but he's operating on an 18-month-old level. And he has autism, or is on the spectrum of autism. And he has an expressive receptive language disorder.
Mm.
And they named off a few other things too, hyperactivity, things like that, which we knew that very well. kind of give us a grim diagnosis. And we had an hour drive home. And for young parents like us, that was rough. That was rough,
I remember walking the door at home, laying across the bed, and at times in life you're trying to figure out God's plan. That never meshes well. God's plan is always the perfect plan. And for his children. And so I lay across the bed, and I'm not trying to bargain with God. I'm just saying, God, you made Aaron. And if this is the capacity that we have to deal with as parents, then we're gonna do our very best.
Yeah.
And I come to this thought that if he doesn't speak another word, that one day in heaven, maybe we could sit down and he could share. And I still think to a degree throughout those first few years, maybe because there's things that even Aaron still doesn't understand or comprehend. But nonetheless, I laid across the bed and I thought to myself, Lord, if you choose to touch him in any capacity, we're going to give you glory. And we will make sure that everybody hears the story. Well, God had that perfect plan just several months later.
Be careful what you pray for, because if you ask it, you're going to receive it. And we had no clue that it was going to be this busy.
Yeah. And so from that moment when he spoke, it was just simple words, you know, it was Dad. And I think his words were, I want something to drink or something like that. And you would have might as well give me $1 million that day, because that was just as important or just as special in our life. And to see God take his testimony, which that song, Centered by Grace, is his testimony song. Mm. Those first two lines, if you could see what I once was, if you could go with me back to where I started from, then I know that you would see a miracle.
Wow.
And that's what we have. We have a miracle.
Yeah. Yeah.
We
Amen.
Do.
Yeah. Well, you do shine, and the anointing of the Holy Ghost is on you, Aaron. Do you feel that? You feel the anointing?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, and God is using you in a great way. I tell you, I felt his spirit when you were singing. That's powerful. Mm-hmm. Now, you recently were awarded an award. Tell us about that. I think we may have a picture, do we, Charlotte? Yeah. Have the picture of you receiving the award.
We were at a convention called Creekside. And
there it is.
There's Aaron. You got the Spirit Award.
That's a big award.
Yeah, it was really big for a really big guy,
That's it.
I sure am.
Yeah, everybody at that convention.
That's a diamond award, is that right?
Yeah.
A diamond.
Yeah.
Okay. You have it in your room?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, yes.
In my room.
On display.
Absolutely,
all
now.
All the time, right?
Yeah. That night was amazing. We had finished our set there on the stage, and we started to go down, and they wouldn't let us go off the stage. And I thought, well, something wrong. Did we do something wrong? You know, next thing I know, here comes Miss Vonda walking up the steps, and I could just hear this, I don't know, this intense
roar
of people. They knew what was going on. We didn't know what was going on. And then they said that he's awarded the Spirit Award during the Diamond Awards, and that he has the, what was it? He shined the most and had a great attitude.
People voted, from the convention.
Yep. Well, he always had a smile on his face, and that's Aaron. He always has a smile.
That's awesome.
I am.
You have the joy of the Lord.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
It comes through in a powerful way.
Thank you.
You guys are special parents, just in giving your life. And I know you pastored 18 years, that right? And then you've put that on the altar to just get out and evangelize and sing and worship and lead churches. Yeah. Tell us, how did the Lord put that on your heart?
Yes, ma'am. We pastored for 18 years, and about a year before, this past February is when we went to the church and we stepped down, and God worked all that out. But about a year before that, we had been praying about it, and God had given this answer, but we wanted to do it in His time. We didn't want to jump ahead. And so as things got closer, our singing picked up, and it got to where we were at a point where we're juggling. You know, we're committed to the flock there at the church and the community, and then we wanted to be able to share. And one of the unique things about our ministry and our singing is Aaron's testimony, because there's so many people out there with special needs.
Yeah.
And they need to know that there is hope.
Yes.
There is joy.
Yes.
And we know that none of us are perfect. None of us are, in a place where we're without flaw.
That's
and
right.
so the story had to be told, and we're still telling it today and everywhere we go. So as it got closer,
and I want to say thank you, Aaron, for sharing it, because you could say, okay, I don't want to talk about it, or I don't want to be transparent, but you've made that sacrifice.
My pleasure.
Well, it's amazing, and people do need to hear it.
Yes, and so it got to a point, and the phone started ringing, emails. And from that moment on, we stepped off, and outside of Easter Sunday and this past Sunday, since February the 9th, we have had somewhere preaching, singing, sharing, and it hasn't ended. The rest of the year is very, very booked up, and we're excited. excited already about next year and what God's doing.
And we know that it is a total God thing because every weekend we are approached by someone who says, thank you for sharing.
Yes.
You know, thank you for telling about him.
Yeah.
I have a granddaughter, I have a niece, or I have a daughter, I have a son.
Mm-hmm. So I have a nephew.
We get the stories and we love it. We love the stories we get and we love to have others to pray for. We love that.
Yes, we need that ministry at this time. Yes. What do you see happening in churches as you go out and minister, and what's God saying? What do you feel for the
church? It's amazing. As we've gotten on this side of the COVID thing and people starting to come back together, I see that people have seen how life is fragile.
Yes.
Wow.
Just like that, things got. And so there is, even though there might be some places where pastors say we're not at full steam like we were, but it seems like there's more of a commitment to those that are there because they understand how life can go up, turn upside down fast.
Yes.
But so wonderfully, though, in the middle of all that is God is still faithful.
Amen.
He has never failed. Mm-hmm. And so to be able to share the stories that we have, even in our ministry side, even in when we were pastoring and by the bedside of many people and had to be at the funeral home many times and get the calls in the middle of the night.
We were reminded
every day, but even now we're able to go out and hear those stories of other people because at the product table we're standing and we become containers.
Yes.
They get to pour out their self into us because they see the road that we've been down and that we understand to a degree what they're going through.
And Bethany, how do you feel that, you know, young people are responding to the message and the music?
I'm really happy about it. When I see somebody or some girl like my age or somebody who's nervous, I'm like, it's scary at first, but once you get used to it, it's easy and the Lord will help you through it. And it's fun whenever you get to start doing it because you get to meet new people. You get to hear other stories about something similar like Aaron's story or some other things like that.
Yeah. So, and you do not see that many 17-year-olds out singing Southern gospel music. So we're very blessed.
You know, Charlotte she has so many wonderful contacts in gospel music and bringing in families that sing together, you know, and I always think, what are the behind the scenes? What are some of the, Alicia, you could tell us, what's some of the behind the scenes with traveling?
It gets very interesting at times, but you know, with sisters traveling together, that's interesting in itself.
Wow.
But no, we have honestly had the best time traveling. You know, there are tough times.
Yeah.
We had tough times on the way here, but I mean, we weather those things. We get through those things. Those things make us stronger as family, as a group, and for the future, what comes ahead. Because, you know, our witness is given to us for a reason because there's somebody else out there that's going through that same thing.
Absolutely.
And they're going to need some help.
Amen.
And so that's what, you know, us traveling as family, we're going to go through things and there's going to be other families out there that need the help.
That's right. When you felt that initial still small voice or that nudge in your spirit, y'all need to be doing more, you need to be stepping out and singing, and you showed up at their doorstep, how did you hear that or how did you sense that?
We just recently talked about that.
Yeah.
Because she's been singing since she was 4 years old.
I can tell.
I didn't start singing until I was 18 years old.
Wow.
I was the shy one. I hid behind mom in church.
Did y'all grow up in a musical family?
In musical family. Okay. Our dad's a preacher.
Okay.
And so it was a big step of faith for me.
Wow.
That was I feel like it was like a test of faith for me to take that step. I was scared to death because, you know, I love singing. She's my favorite singer.
Yeah. Aww.
And so I've always loved hearing her sing and watching her sing with others. And I just wanted that.
Yeah.
I felt the knock on my heart that's
the drawing.
What I wanted to do, the draw on my heart.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. That's awesome. And you responded, and thank y'all for that, for stepping up for the call. of the call of Christ to get out and evangelize, and we need it. People are hungry right now, aren't they?
They are.
Yeah.
They are. And we're a product, you're talking about family, and we're all products of our family. They're investing so much in our lives.
Yes.
Their dad was pastor. My family sang for 40 years. I was raised on a bus, and my grandfather wrote many, many songs for the Primitive Quartet. So I know many people know Primitive Quartet.
Yes.
And so he wrote many songs. And so I was raised in all that. And then how I saw the dynamic. I've been in other quartets and groups, but when it's family, it's just something different.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
something special.
It is.
And I wake up every day, and when we get on the bus or we get in the truck or whatever we have to do to get somewhere,
whatever
and we figure out whatever way it is to get to places, sometimes you have to get creative if you have a problem. But nonetheless, we still weather those things, and we still have that bond, and that's what I'm so thankful. We have the same heart, the same attitude, the same desire.
That's
so
awesome.
That's God.
Well, thank y'all for coming, and thank you to our friend Charlie Sexton for introducing y'all and bringing you. What a great night.
Thank you so much.
Hey, tell everybody as we're closing out tonight, how can they get in touch with you? I know pastors are watching and may want to have you
come. Sure, yeah. So if you can spell our last name, that's really all you got to get. P-Y-L-A-N-T. ThePylantFamily.com.
Yep.
Pretty simple. It has everything about us, information, how to get us, where we're going, our CDs, our product, everything.
Yep.
Facebook at The Pylant Family. So if you can't do anything, go to Google and put in Pylant Family, and you'll get the things that's out there.
You just have
Pylant
to spell
is
it
not
correctly.
Out there, correct.
Yeah. Yeah. You just have to spell it correctly.
That's
Other than
awesome.
That, we're easy.
Well, y'all have been so much fun tonight. Thank you. Thank you for bringing the good news and the gospel through song. We hope you've enjoyed it tonight. Thank you for being with us. It's been a joy to be in your home, to be with you wherever you are. Tune in with us each night and you'll get the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We love you and Jesus loves you. We'll see you next time right here on Atlanta Live. God bless.